people. I hope you're doing well, my de-lovelies, so let me give you something that may contain science. And then take it away from you, because the science is not good for you. The science in question involves brominated vegetable oil, which the US Food and Drug Administration has recently proposed to remove from authorized use as an additive in food. But let's dive a little deeper into that, because brominated vegetable oil is actually a great example of how food chemistry can seem fine, how research can prove it's not fine, and how long it can take for regulations to catch up. But before anything else, what the absolute heckity is brominated vegetable oil, and why is it in our food in the first place? Well, it's genuinely what it sounds like. It's a vegetable oil with bromine added to it. Bromine is a halogen like chlorine and iodine, and that'll all become very relevant later. As you go down the halogen family column, the elements start incredibly, wildly electronegative. Fluorine is literally the most electronegative element, and you absolutely do not want to F with it in its pure state. Chlorine isn't the literally most electronegative, because that position is held, as we mentioned, by fluorine, but it is also very reactive, and this trend continues down the column with bromine. It's chiller than fluorine and chlorine, but that isn't saying much. And like those elements, pure bromine is terribly toxic. But the properties of this family also make them incredibly powerful in chemistry. Yes, we're all familiar with sodium chloride, fluoride in our toothpaste, and all the zillions of compounds that exist in nature and contain these common elements. We've also previously noted their use in industrial production. Think of PVC or polyvinyl chloride. Think of poly and perfluoral alkyl substances, like Teflon. I'm not citing these to say, ooh, scary chemicals. And for the record, if you see any stories equating brominated vegetable oil with brominated fire extinguisher materials, that's misleading. The point is that the halogen family is part of a bunch of things, including a very wide range of synthesized chemicals. And like those chemicals, brominated vegetable oil was synthesized in the 20th century, and at first, it seemed like a pretty chill and useful chemical. Brominated vegetable oil was first synthesized in the 1920s, and it's most commonly used in citrus soda and sports drinks. Those drinks are flavored using oils, so on their own, the flavor oils would separate out from the water of the beverage. Brominated vegetable oil, then, is an emulsifier that keeps the flavor oils evenly distributed through the soda. Not a true solution, but close enough for soda. Because it's been in use for so long, brominated vegetable oil has historically enjoyed a legacy status with the FDA called generally recognized as safe. If a substance was commonly used in food products before 1958, with a lot of people consuming it for a long time, that substance may be generally recognized as safe on the thinking that, well, if it had problems, we'd probably have noticed by now. This is different than how the FDA deems a food substance, to be generally recognized as safe through scientific procedure, though that process isn't flawless either, but we can at least see the logic that would let us use decades of mass consumption as evidence that a food substance may be generally recognized as safe. I mean, imagine if the FDA was like, I know we've been eating bread for thousands of years, but I'm gonna need some studies before I let you loaf around freely. But just because something looks okay at first doesn't mean that the chemical is intrinsically totally safe. Remember, poly and perfluoral alkyl substances were initially thought to be totally inert in the body, and now we know that really, really isn't true. And in fact, there have been concerns about brominated vegetable oil since the 60s. By 1970, health agencies around the world found there was sufficient evidence to connect brominated vegetable oil to health problems, and the FDA downgraded it from generally recognized as safe to, well, you can use it as long as it's no more than 15 parts per million. I mean, that's just 0.0015% of the whole food product, and if that seems like it still might be more than you would like, know that the FDA also has a limit on the amount of arsenic that can be used as a food additive. 0.5 parts per million, by the way. Mostly in poultry, probably because there's also an allowable amount of arsenic in poultry feed. The point is, the dose makes the poison, and there's nothing inherently wrong with setting a rule that you can have a substance in food as long as you have very, 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 very little of it. But while the FDA was restricting the amount of brominated vegetable oil that could go in our sodas, other health agencies were banning the substance entirely. In 1970, the same year that the FDA placed these restrictions, the UK banned brominated vegetable oil entirely from use as a food substance, as did several European countries, with India following in 1990 and Japan in 2010. But why is brominated vegetable oil a problem in the first place? After all, that halogen family, kind of scary and toxic as elements, but we literally need some of them to live. And that's exactly the problem. I talked about bromine earlier in the context of fluorine and chlorine earlier, but look at what's below bromine in the halogen family. Iodine. Following the periodic trend, iodine is less electronegative than bromine in our bodies, specifically our thyroid, absolutely require iodine to make thyroxine and triiodothyronine, which are collectively our thyroid hormone. Thyroid hormone regulates our heart and respiratory rate, our ability to generate heat as warm-blooded beings. It governs our metabolism, even our brain development. As a heavier and comparatively rarer element, we humans only take in iodine in trace amounts, and yet up to 38% of people around the world have iodine deficiency with attendant health effects for all of those things. And over the past few decades, research has shown that elevated intake of bromides replaces iodine in the thyroid, reducing the iodinated thyronines that the thyroid can produce. In response, the body produces more thyroid-stimulating hormone, enlarging the thyroid as it tries to catch more iodine to compensate for the bromine-induced interference. That's one reason that brominated vegetable oil is called an endocrine-disrupting chemical. It takes the place of its chemically similar halogen counterpart, but it can't actually be used to make the iodine-containing hormones our body needs. And at higher intake levels, chronic bromide consumption has a neurotoxic effect. Bromism used to be a serious problem back when bromide salts were used as a sleep aid, and that's still a problem, thanks to random supplements on the internet. Thanks, internet. But brominated vegetable oil can, at least in principle, have the same effect as these bromide salts. One 1997 case report from the Journal of Toxicology, Clinical Toxicology, described a man with severe neurological symptoms that were ultimately attributed to bromism from his consumption of 2 to 4 liters a day of cola that contained, yes, that's right, brominated vegetable oil. And yeah, should you be drinking 2 to 4 liters of soda a day, every day? No, absolutely not. But again, this happened in 1997. Meaning that the 15 parts per million restrictions on brominated vegetable oil had already been in place for decades when this case happened. We expect that downing a 2 liter of soda every day would maybe not be great for you, but we think of it usually more in a, this is not a great life choice, I should really consume less sugar kind of way. Not in the GLaDOS releasing the neurotoxin way. But that's precisely the problem. Different substances become an issue at different intake levels and consumption rates. We might think that going through a 2 liter of soda every week or two, rather than every day, like that case report, is reasonable intake. And that can be true from a sugar perspective, but a reasonable sugar intake from a soda could still give you too much bromine. And the truth is, we don't really know how much brominated vegetable oil is safe to consume long term. When the FDA restricted brominated vegetable oil to 15 parts per million in beverages back in 1970, no long-term studies were available to support that limit. We only knew that that amount wasn't an immediate short-term health threat. Now, since then, the FDA has asked for more robust studies to assess thyroid toxicity, developmental neurotoxicity, reproductive toxicity, and bioaccumulation of lipid bound bromines, like brominated vegetable oils, but the research has been sparse, and as even the FDA admits in this recent proposed revocation of authorization, those studies sucked. They didn't say it, but they kind of did. Since 1970, we've known that lipid-bound bromines can accumulate in the brain, liver, and spleen of both rats and humans. In fact, they found that people, especially kids, from places with sodas that used brominated vegetable oil had high levels of tissue bromine, while people from places without brominated vegetables had minimal levels. But the hope was that by reducing the levels of brominated vegetable oil in the soda, you'd bring intake levels down to low enough at least that the body could clear it out in a reasonable time frame. But as the FDA tried to figure out how long it takes to clear these substances from your body, data indicated that brominated fatty acids could persist in test animals for a year and a half, which is pretty much as long as they had the test animals themselves. So with even more data demonstrating toxicity and bioaccumulation potential, the FDA no longer has reasonable certainty that brominated vegetable oils are harmless. But yeah, let's ask the obvious. Why in heaven's name did it take the FDA so long when other countries have banned brominated vegetable oils for over 50 years? John Oliver recently did a fantastic piece on the desperately underfunded and understaffed food safety side of the FDA, which has created a glacially slow bureaucracy that may well have contributed to this whole situation. But this is May Contain Science, and we try to contain no more than 15 parts per million of public policy. That said, where the two meet is the scientific approach we take to determining safety. Generally recognized as safe makes a lot of intuitive sense as a standard, but lead paint and makeup were once generally recognized as safe. Over and over again, regulators initially allow substances from brominated vegetable oils to poly and perfluoral alkyl substances because they seem okay, only to discover, after we've mass-produced and exposed people to them for decades, that, oopsies, we probably shouldn't have done that. The FDA doesn't take this kind of YOLO approach to drug development, but if they'd applied that same safety-first, approval-afterward energy to the food additives they regulate, we'd have a far more robust scientific understanding of the additives we permit in our food supply. So, where does this leave us? Well, if you live somewhere that's already banned brominated vegetable oils, fantastic. Even in the US, only a small percentage of drinks still include brominated vegetable oils, and most manufacturers have voluntarily swapped over to different emulsifiers, if only to streamline the production process for international use. If the proposed rule at the FDA is finalized, manufacturers will have 1 year to remove the brominated vegetable oils from US food production. More generally, I think we take from this that we've got to put more respect on the science of safety. Researchers are only human, and it's tempting to focus on flashy breakthrough research to cure diseases or develop awesome new synthetic materials to save the world. And for a lot of people, it's much less sexy to study whether that new material is actually safe to use. And that's just plain wrong. Safety science can be incredibly cool. I mean, we just looked at the periodic table to contextualize a thyroid phenomenon. Science is a human institution by and for humans, and it's important that our processes of discovery lend themselves to improving the world around us. No scientist ever got into the field because they want to make human life worse. And Just like a proofreader catches typos to make the writer look good, public safety and robust research make inventors look good. Something to think about, I suppose, as I sip my citrus soda. Now with no bromine.